Hello, I'm Seth Schwartz. I'm a cochlear implant surgeon and the director of the Listen for Life Center at Virginia Mason. I work with an outstanding team, all of whom are dedicated to helping people with hearing loss optimize their hearing abilities. We performed our first cochlear implant in 1979 and continue to offer our patients, both adults and children, the benefits of the latest emerging technology. In this video, you'll meet our cochlear implant team and learn what this procedure could mean for you. First, I'd like to help you better understand hearing loss and the differences between hearing aids and cochlear implants. This is an illustration of normal hearing. Sound is captured by the outer ear and directed toward the eardrum. Those vibrations travel through the hearing bones and send a wave of fluid through the inner ear. The fluid bends the hair cells, sending a signal along the auditory nerve and up to the brain. Hearing loss most often occurs when the inner ear is no longer working, usually as a result of damage to some or all of the hair cells of the inner ear. Hearing aids make acoustic sounds louder, and they rely on some working hair cells in the inner ear for hearing. Hearing aids are appropriate for mild, moderate, and severe hearing loss, and they require one external part worn on the ear. Cochlear implants bypass the inner ear by changing acoustic sounds into electrical energy, which then stimulates the hearing nerve. This approach is only for those with severe or profound hearing loss who are no longer getting benefit from a hearing aid. The device entails an external part and an internal or implanted part.
I'm Carrie Witherell, an audiologist on the team, and we're going to look at how a cochlear implant might help you.
If you think you're a candidate for a cochlear implant, the process begins with a consultation, both with an audiologist and with the surgeon. Those visits will determine if you are a candidate based on your hearing and other factors. An MRI or CT scan will also be used to provide a visual image of the inner ear. You'll be required to have a meningitis vaccination, and your insurance authorization will be confirmed for the procedure. We will then choose which ear to implant and which device is best for you. We'll also cover any counseling issues or questions that may arise. At this point, if you are ready, you can schedule the surgery.
I'm Satsuko Murakami, a cochlear implant audiologist and the pediatric specialist with the Listen for Life Center. The process is different for children than for adults for cochlear implantation. Children may require some extra special testing in order to determine their specific levels of hearing loss. Once the level of hearing loss is determined, then the child will go through a hearing aid trial period. And during the hearing aid trial period, the educators, parents, and the cochlear implant team will all work together and will assess whether or not the child is making progress with the hearing aids. If they're not making progress with the hearing aids, if they have a severe to profound loss, they'll become candidates for the cochlear implant. At this point, children also require special imaging and vaccination in order to prevent meningitis.
I'm Allison Zarkos, another audiologist at the Listen for Life Center, and next we're going to take a look at the actual cochlear implant device. The device consists of two parts. The internal component has a receiver stimulator and an electrode array, and this is implanted by the surgeon. The external device is worn on the outside, typically over your ear. It's composed of the processor, the cable, the coil, and a power source. After implantation, the internal and external devices are held together by magnets, and they communicate by radio waves. Prior to scheduling surgery, you'll be asked to select your device. You'll be given detailed information regarding the three principal manufacturers. However, we encourage you to do some research on your own. You can do this by visiting the manufacturer websites or by watching the video addendum A. The factors that may influence the selection of your device include lifestyle, cosmetics, how the device actually looks, the accessories, dexterity, actual control of the device, and battery options, rechargeable or disposable.
Let's look at how the implant will help you. There is a range of individual outcomes and a variety of factors that can influence individual performance. These factors can include the health of the cochlea and the response of the nerves, consistent device use, having a good support system of family and friends, motivation to practice, your main mode of communication, mental health and well-being, and also having realistic expectations. Outcomes for children are also variable. Factors such as the age at which a child is implanted, as well as whether or not there are cognitive issues, those can all play a part in how a child does with their implant. in general, after they're given a period of time to catch up, children will be able to acquire language and will be able to eventually communicate through listening and speaking.
Outcomes with cochlear implants cannot always be predicted. The benefit of the implant can be as small as helping with awareness of sound to as great as being able to more easily understand speech in noisy surroundings. Your individual outcome will be based in large part on the previously mentioned factors. A cochlear implant is different than getting used to a new pair of glasses or a new hearing aid. There is a period of learning that must take place with a cochlear implant. This hearing or auditory skill development is different for each person. Some people may require extra work to improve their auditory skills. That process is called oral rehabilitation. Since they may have never heard or spoken before, young children might require even more intense speech and language training in order to understand and produce speech like their peers.
The Listen for Life Center has contacts with many oral rehabilitation clinics in the Pacific Northwest. You'll receive a handout that will cover many of these frequently asked questions.
Now, let's address the actual surgical experience and some of the risks of surgery. On your surgery day, you'll be asked to arrive at the hospital about 1 hour before your scheduled surgery. An interpreter will be available if needed. The operation itself takes from 1 to 1.5 hours and is done using a general anesthetic that allows you to sleep during the entire procedure. A small incision is made behind the ear and a pocket created where the implant will be placed beneath the skin. The cochlea is identified and a small opening is made into the cochlea itself. The electrode is inserted into the cochlea and sealed in position. The surgeon then closes the incision. When the surgery is completed, you will wake up in the operating room and be transferred to a recovery area where you can meet up with your family and friends. Then, after a period of recovery, you'll be discharged from the hospital and be able to go home the same day. In general, the surgery is very safe, but as with any surgery, there are a few potential risks. Bleeding, infection, or other wound healing problems can occur. There is a small risk of abnormal taste sensations, postoperative dizziness, facial weakness, or failure of the device itself. Meningitis is a very rare complication. A poor hearing result is one additional potential risk. Please view the additional section of this video on risks of surgery for a more detailed explanation of these risks. You will not be hearing immediately after your surgery. In about a week's time, we'll schedule an appointment for the activation of your device. That is when you will begin your hearing experience.
I've been thinking about getting this done for the last 8 years, but what made it kind of go official is I have a nephew that was born on November 1st, and I really want to be able to understand him when he gets older. So that's one of the things was the reasons why. And plus, you know, someday if I have children of my own, I want to be able to understand them.
Is it getting better?
Yeah, very much better.
Very good. I'm just going to take a little look at your ear, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Looks perfect. Okay. We'll let you go ahead and get activated at this point. This is when the fun begins. Okay?
Okay.
Do you have any questions for me?
Nope.
Okay. Very good to see you again.
These are sounds that your brain hasn't really heard for a while, some of these high-pitched ones.
Right.
So that's why they sound a little strange and irritating.
Like overwhelming.
Mm-hmm.
A little.
But you'll get used to them over time.
Right.
But they're just a little irritating at first, and that's normal. I'm going to go ahead and take it up just a little bit, okay? Okay, Sally, we're back on. Can you hear my voice?
A little tiny bit.
How does it sound?
Very robotic.
Okay.
I feel like it's getting a lot better. I can hear the clock ticking. I can hear my neighbors next door to my apartment. I can hear my dog's collar chain tinkling, you know, and I never really noticed that before.
In a series of follow-up visits in the weeks and months after surgery, our team will continue to guide you to help you improve your auditory experience made possible by the implant. We will provide the personalized support you may need to get the most out of your cochlear implant. We encourage you to watch this video more than once with your friends and family, and to watch the additional sections which focus on important parts of the cochlear implant process. Cochlear implantation can be a life-changing process, and we at the Listen for Life Center never lose our enthusiasm for sharing this experience with you.
Now, Casey, go ahead and talk.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
The pre-op counseling begins by determining if the patient meets the audiometric criteria for cochlear implantation. Other factors may include active ear infections, no hearing nerve, patient not healthy enough for surgery, and unrealistic expectations. The process from this point entails audiologic counseling, meeting with the surgeon to discuss questions and expectations, MRI or CT scan, meningitis vaccination, insurance authorization if appropriate, and then scheduling the surgery. We'll help you to understand that a cochlear implant consists of two components: an internal implanted device that includes a receiver stimulator and the electrode array, and an external device or processor that can include power supply, transmitting coil and cable, program and volume controls, and an ear hook. A cochlear implant requires an outpatient surgery that takes about 1 hour and is performed with general anesthesia. Questions about the surgery are addressed in the addendum entitled The Surgery Experience. The audiologist will counsel patients about expectations connected to cochlear implant outcomes. Just how the patient will do is unknown, and outcomes vary. You should think about your own expectations and how well you hope to do with a cochlear implant. Factors may include duration of hearing loss, hearing aid use, consistent use of the cochlear implant, motivation to practice, and a good support network. Some patients will gain sound awareness and improved lip reading. Others may hear and understand speech without visual cues. You'll discuss listening to and enjoying music and talking on the telephone. Consistent follow-up and practice are important for success. 7 appointments will be required during the first year of implementation: surgery, initial activation, then after initial activation, follow-ups at 1 week, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and 1 year. At these appointments, the processor will need to be remapped often as the brain continues to adjust to the new sounds it is receiving. After the first year, patients are seen on an annual basis. Practice is another key. The more a patient practices using the implant, the quicker they will adjust to this new mode of hearing. If still using a hearing aid on the non-implanted ear, we recommend removing it for a few hours each night and using only the implant. Practice listening tasks might include reading aloud to oneself, having a family member read aloud to the patient, listening to books on tape, or looking for rehabilitation DVDs to guide practice. Ask about referral for professional oral rehabilitation services. The Listen for Life Center can help. The audiologist will counsel the patient on the features of specific cochlear implant devices. Details about the various available devices are presented in the addendum entitled Device Selection. Finally, the audiologist will answer any remaining questions the patient may have and provide brochures and other printed materials. Patients are encouraged to call with any follow-up questions.
I'm Setsuko Murakami, cochlear implant audiologist with the Listen for Life team at Virginia Mason. And I'll just be giving you a general overview today of the 3 different manufacturers for the cochlear implants. And that will help just guide your decision in choosing which implant manufacturer that would fit your lifestyle the best. This is the Cochlear America's N5 system. This is a CP810, the behind-the-ear external sound processor made by Cochlear America's. This is a CI24RE,
the internal implant for Cochlear America's N5 system. There are both rechargeable and disposable battery options for this processor. For rechargeable battery options, there are two sizes, a larger size, as well as a smaller size battery. The smaller size doesn't last quite as long, but it can be more comfortable with people who have smaller ears. There's also a disposable battery option where you just slide off the battery cover and you can fit two of the disposable batteries. This processor has two buttons that can help you change programs or volume, as well as it has an LED light that can help you monitor the status of the sound processor, and that light can be disabled if you don't want to use it. Cochlear America's system comes with a remote to help you control their sound processor. One thing that their system is known for is what they call smart sound programs, where you can change the various programs depending on the area you're in to help adjust for varying background noise, for instance, in the car or in a restaurant. The Cochlear America's remote control has the various program options as well as volume control and sensitivity control. For some patients, they find that this remote control can be a little bit more complicated. If you're uncomfortable with technology, then this remote control could present some challenges for you. This processor has a little door that can be opened to open up a port where you can plug in a cable from an external audio source such as an iPod. These are the main base colors that are available for the device. You can choose one color for the entire system, or you can mix and match the colors that you use. Also available are some additional color sleeves that you can slide over the processor if you would like to add some extra color. This is the Medel Maestro system. There's the Concert internal implant, the Opus 2 external sound processor, and also a remote control. This is Medel's Concert internal implant. It's known for having such a thin profile. This internal implant has a longer electrode array with the goal of stimulating more low-frequency areas of the cochlea to help with a more natural sound quality when listening to music. This is the Opus 2 sound processor of the Medel Maestro system. There are both disposable and rechargeable battery options. The disposable option requires three batteries. Similar to other systems, the Medel Opus 2 has a direct connect option. There are three holes at the bottom where you can plug in an FM system receiver or a direct connect cable leading to an audio system like an iPod. The Medel Opus 2 uses automatic sound management, which allows the processor to automatically adjust for different levels of background noise. So when you look at the processor, there are no external buttons on here. That allows this processor to be a little bit smaller in its design. It additionally has a light here that can turn on and off to show you what program you're using or the sound processor status. This is the remote control for the Medel Opus 2. It allows you to select various programs, change the volume, as well as change the microphone sensitivity. This remote is somewhat simpler and therefore more user-friendly. The Medel Opus 2 is available in a wide variety of colors. This is the Advanced Bionics Hi-Res 90K system with the Hi-Res 90K internal implant and the Harmony external sound processor. You'll notice that there's no remote control for this system. And for some patients who feel like they might lose a remote control easily, this is a nice option. This is the Advanced Bionics Hi-Res 90K internal implant. It uses the Hi-Res Fidelity 120 sound processing technology. And this sound processing technology utilizes what Advanced Bionics calls their current steering, and that is to increase the number of pitches heard with the goal of hearing speech better in noise and experiencing improvements in music and overall sound quality. This is the Advanced Bionics Harmony sound processor. It has only rechargeable batteries as an option. There are two sizes of rechargeable batteries. This is the larger size, and there's also a smaller size that's a little bit lighter to wear behind your ear, but it lasts a little bit less time before you have to recharge it. The rechargeable battery can be slid off to turn the power off for the processor, and then you can slide it on to turn the power back on. There's no on-off switch for the processor, and for some people with dexterity problems, this can be a nice option. The Harmony processor has a switch
that you can use to select one of three different programs, as well as a volume control dial that you can use to increase or decrease the volume, and also an indicator light that can be used to help show the status of the sound processor. The Harmony sound processor has an ear hook that's called the T-mic. It's designed to sit at the entrance of your ear canal to help capture the sound in front of you rather than behind you and to the side. It's additionally called the T-mic because if you're able to understand over the telephone, you can center the receiver of the phone over this T-mic rather than having to center the receiver of the phone up higher over the processor's microphone. If you want to switch to a different type of ear hook, you can use a standard ear hook instead. And when you use a standard ear hook, you would then be using the processor's microphone rather than that T-mic. The Harmony sound processor also has additional ear hooks that can be used. These ear hooks can be a direct audio input ear hook that can be connected to a cable that runs to an audio interface device like an iPod, or a different type of ear hook that can run straight to an FM receiver. There are three standard colors for the Harmony processor, as well as additional color caps that can be used for decoration. This is the Advanced Bionics Neptune sound processor. It does take one AAA battery that can be either disposable or a rechargeable battery. This is a very nice option because you can buy this type of battery at any drugstore. The Neptune sound processor has a power button that when you press and hold it, it will turn on. And it also has an LED indicator to tell you the power status and the battery status. The sound processor additionally has volume and sensitivity controls, and it has a port for an FM receiver, and also a port for a direct audio input connection to a device like an iPod. On the side of the Neptune sound processor is a switch to choose one of three different program options. There are a variety of different color options available, as well as a clip that can be used to attach the processor to your belt or your collar, and some people even opt to clip the processor in their hair. The Neptune is so named because it's the only cochlear implant sound processor that can be made waterproof. In order to make it waterproof, you must first adjust your program to the desired setting and then remove your control panel and replace it with a waterproof cap. The last step to make the device waterproof is to replace the headpiece with the waterproof AquaMic. This is a first in cochlear implant technology. The Neptune sound processor is guaranteed to be fully waterproof.
Generally speaking, the cochlear implant surgery is a very safe procedure. The surgical team has a long and successful record with this surgery, having performed more than 600 implants since the late 1970s. With any surgery, however, there are a few potential risks, though every precaution is taken so that they are avoided altogether. The potential risks can include bleeding, infection, or other wound healing problems can occur. There is a small risk of abnormal taste sensations. In a small number of cases, post-operative dizziness or facial weakness can occur for a short interval of time after the surgery. Because the implants are a mechanical device, there is a slight risk of the failure of the device itself. This happens very infrequently. Meningitis is a very rare complication, and patients are required to have a vaccination as an additional safeguard. The ultimate goal for cochlear implant surgery is to bring about a substantial improvement in hearing for those with severe to profound hearing losses. Still, in a small number of cases, a poorer than expected hearing result occurs, and that has to be included as an additional risk of surgery. After a patient qualifies for surgery, insurance coverage for the procedure will be confirmed with the patient's insurance plan. The patient then selects the type of implant that they want with guidance from the Listen for Life team. The patient is given instructions about preparing for surgery and for exactly what to expect on the day of the procedure. This includes exactly where to go, what time to be there, and what to bring. On the date of surgery, the patient is asked to arrive at Virginia Mason about 1 hour before the procedure is scheduled to begin. An interpreter will be available if needed. After checking in, the patient will be taken first to the induction room where he or she will meet the anesthesiologist. Your surgeon will also see you at this time and place a mark on the ear chosen for the implant. An IV will be placed here and a light sedative may be administered. The patient is then transported to the operating room where they will be placed under general anesthesia. This allows the patient to sleep during the entire procedure. The implant operation usually takes from 1 to 1.5 hours. A small incision is made behind the ear and a pocket is created where the implant will be placed. The stimulating electrode is inserted into the cochlea and sealed in position. The surgeon then closes the incision. The patient will not be hearing immediately after surgery because the device is not yet activated. When the surgery is completed, the patient will awaken in the operating room and then will be transferred to a recovery area where they can be together with family and friends. After a period of recovery, the patient is discharged from the hospital and is able to go home on the same day. In rare cases, an overnight hospital stay may be required. The morning after surgery, the patient can remove the dressing. Since the wound is sealed with glue, they are welcome to shower and even wash their hair. A follow-up appointment is scheduled approximately 1 week after the surgery, when the surgeon will check the incision and the implanted device is activated for the first time.
Typically, that's a decision that's left up to the patient. Sometimes if patients have a medical reason, such as if they get chronic ear infections, or maybe if there's any physical abnormalities, then the surgeon will let you know whether you should implant one ear or for the other. Otherwise, there may be other factors that you as a patient might want to consider, such as how long you've gone without hearing, whether or not you've ever used a hearing aid in either ear, as well as if you have residual hearing that you'd like to hold on to in one of your ears.
Most patients would select the poor ear to be implanted and save the better ear for use with a hearing aid, and this will give you better overall or binaural hearing. In the beginning, many patients report it sounds like beeping and tones, and over time, some patients also say it becomes cartoon-like, so voices sound like Mickey Mouse or Donald Duck.
For most patients on their first day with the implant, they can detect environmental sounds, and with a little bit of practice, they're able to recognize those environmental sounds. Speech, on the other hand, takes a little bit longer to understand.
Over the first 3 to 6 months, sometimes even 9 months, as your brain is able to make use of that information, the speech sounds become more normal. Never like your natural hearing, but patients do report it becomes more natural and easier to understand. Attendance at your audiology appointments and regular use of your device can speed along your progression towards a more normal hearing experience with your cochlear implant. Music appreciation with a cochlear implant is a very unique and individual experience. Unlike speech, music appreciation takes into account an individual's musical knowledge or their history and experience with music, as well as their ability to make use of the sounds through the cochlear implant.
Because music is such a dynamic sort of signal, it changes a lot. And so your brain really has to work hard to understand what it's hearing. Typically, patients will say that they can recognize kind of the beat or the rhythm of the music first, and over time they can sometimes recognize a simple melody, and then some patients can even recognize some of the lyrics. The more that you practice with your implant and listening to music, that can really help you enjoy music much more. The internal device is designed to last a lifetime. It does have a warranty of 10 years.
There is a small incidence of failure, sometimes from a blow to the head or a head injury.
Even with advances in technology, we rarely replace the internal device unless there's some sort of problem with the current implant.
The external portion is much like a hearing aid and suffers wear and tear from everyday use. The lifespan is about 5 to 10 years. The manufacturer does provide a 3-year warranty, and you may elect to extend that before it expires. Technology is constantly evolving, and new processors will become available. You may elect to upgrade to the newer processors without having to have surgery or replacement of your internal device.
Most patients report minimal pain after surgery. You will be prescribed pain medication to get through the early postoperative period. If you experience continued discomfort, you can contact your doctor for assistance. No, your head will not be misshapen. You may be able to feel a slight ridge where the receiver stimulator lies behind your ear. You may be able to feel it by running your hands over the area, but in most people, this will be covered by their hair. No, rarely a very small area behind your ear will be shaved, but that area will not be visible. Typically, you will wait about 1 to 2 weeks before your implant is turned on. During these weeks, you will not be able to hear. This time will allow the incision to heal so that you will not have any discomfort when the implant is put on. You can shower and get your ear wet the day after surgery. People are usually able to go back to work within 3 to 5 days. Occasionally, if there is any residual pain or dizziness, or if your job is very physical, you may take a little longer. We would like you to refrain from straining or lifting anything over 10 pounds for 2 to 3 weeks after surgery. Brisk walking is usually okay within a few days. No, you can fly immediately after surgery. It is safe to take your implant through the metal detector. In general, your device should not trigger the alarms, but you may elect to be wanded instead. You will have an ID card describing your device. No, the powerful magnet of the MRI may interact with the magnet of your implant. If it becomes absolutely necessary to have an MRI, we can surgically remove the magnet temporarily.